flash photography, and as Adam said, we're the Raleigh Outdoor Photography Club. So it seems a bit odd that the Outdoor Photography Club is going to deal with flash, right? Because normally we think outdoor photography, no flash required. Actually, that's not true at all. You need to learn how to use your flash in outdoor photography. Who's taking pictures of people or family or kids or whatever outside in the sun and got really gnarly shadows for the raccoon eyes, gnarly shadows under the chin? Done it before? You need a fill flash. A little bit of flash will raise those shadows. All you can do is actually you can shoot straight on the camera outside. Put the flash right on top of the camera, shoot it straight at them. It actually works pretty well. The trick is though, you want to expose for ambient. Set your camera for your ambient light and put just a tiny little bit of flash in it. Okay? So we did a program about 2 months ago. We did on-camera flash. And I know at least a couple of you were there. So what is the number one biggest problem with on-camera flash? Red eye, that's one of them, but that really is it. But what causes the red?
Overexposure.
Overexposure, yeah. The biggest problem with on-camera flash is the flash is in the absolute worst place it could possibly be. It's right on top of the camera, it shoots straight out, and it shoots a beam about this big, which hits your subject and comes straight back, causing the red eye, right? You've seen the shots where somebody's standing there and there's a big gnarly shadow on the wall behind them? Not very attractive, huh? That's the problem with on-camera flash. And there are ways you can deal with it. You know, in our previous presentation, we did talk about bouncing the flash off the walls and the ceiling behind you, that kind of stuff. So today we're going to talk about doing off-camera flash, which is getting the flash off the camera, shooting it in from an angle, right? That gets rid of the shadow. It softens the flash up dramatically because now the flash goes from really the size of, you know, the flash head being this big. When I bounce it through this reflector, it comes out much larger. Okay? What's the point of that?
Softens
the light. Who said that? Somebody got it just right. It softens that light up. And when taking pictures of people, the last thing you want is really harsh shadows because it's not very flattering. I'm sure you've seen it before. Now, it's not very flattering. So we want to get a light that makes our subject look pleasing in a photo that they wouldn't want to put on Facebook or put online or show to their friends or something like that. So that's the idea behind bouncing it into a reflector of some type. So that's what we're going to do today. All right. We're going to set up. Edna's going to be my model. We're going to set up here and we're going to do some bounce flash photography. Okay. So, couple of ideas. I put this chair up over here where my model is going to sit, and I want it somewhere around that far from the wall. Why?
There's some shadow.
That's right. I don't want that gnarly shadow behind you, right? Get your subject off the wall. I know everybody wants to do this. Everybody's lined up against the wall, take a shot. Big, ugly shadow behind. That's easy to fix. Get them off the wall. I normally do rule of thumb, fingertips off the wall. Pretty good place to start. Okay? It's kind of, you ever wonder why photo studios are so big? Because you have to have that distance. So the next thing we're going to do here is we're going to do a single light setup, which is I'm going to do a single umbrella to light up my model. And as you've seen before, there's thousands of settings on these things. You can do angles and all this kind of good stuff. And you know, like it always is in photography, there are rules and there are rules that can be broken, and we all know that. Generally what I start out with is 45-45. My model is sitting here. I want the light to be about 45 off, coming down from about a 45 degree angle. Now you can change that. If you want to get a different light, of course, make adjustments. Up, down, left, right, change your angle. But a good place to start is, you know, somewhere right along in there. We'll kind of see how it goes. All right? Okay. So, we'll put our model here. We'll get to the camera. We'll get ready to do a couple of shots. All right, my model is getting ready. Okay, good stuff. So we'll take like maybe some headshots of her, maybe from the waist up. That's kind of about what we're going to be shooting for here. We're in a room here where all the lighting is controlled, right? I bring my own lights here. We have a little bit of ambient coming from these that won't factor too much into the shot. For this kind of work, we're shooting the camera in full manual. The flash is manual. We'll be adjusting the flash power by hand, okay? I'm shooting with a 50 millimeter lens. I'm going to be handheld because I want to be able to walk around the room and get different angles of her. What is the minimum shutter speed I should be shooting this lens with? 1 what? 1/50th, or we're down to 1/60th. Where'd you come up with that?
Just from my reading, saying that your flash should not be lower than the millimeter of your length.
That's close enough. But I call it 1 over your focal length. All right? 1 over 50, 1/50th of a second, we round up to 1/60th. Right? So my minimum shutter speed, handheld, is 1/50th of a second. It doesn't matter if you're shooting inside, outside, flash, or not. Anything less than that, and you start getting into camera shape. Blurry shots. Put that 200 millimeter lens on, now your minimum shutter speed is 1/200th. So be careful with that. Tripods obviously can help you with that. Resting on a fence, bracing yourself carefully. There are all kinds of things you can do to gain a little bit more shutter speed out of, or a little less shutter speed. But rule of thumb, 1/50th on a 50 millimeter lens, or 1/60th. Okay. So we'll set up for that. We'll shoot at 1/60th. Now, the next question, aperture. What should my aperture be? It depends on what?
What
I want. Yeah, you're on the right track, so what are you saying there?
If you want the background blurred.
That's right. Depth of field. I'm controlling my depth of field. And that to me is the most important thing when you're taking a portrait, right? You know, how blurry do you want to make the background? Now this lens here goes way down to like f1.2, right? So I could shoot her at 1.2. At this distance, that depth of field is going to be a sliver. I mean, I can get her nose and her eyes sharp and blur out her ears. Could be a look you're after. I don't generally do that, right? There are times in the studio when if I'm doing just the eyes, right? All I want is a real, if the makeup is really good, I'm going to get a real nice tight shot of her eyes, I'll go down to 1.2. But generally, more than that. Somewhere around 6.3 maybe, right? So we'll set up for 1/60th at 6.3 is a good place to start, right? Next setting, ISO. What's my ISO be? 400 is a good place to start.
200?
200 maybe. Generally in the studio I shoot around 400, you know? So if my shutter speed is locked at 1/60th, my aperture is locked at 1/63, I'm adjusting ISO. What's the other side of the seesaw? How much light I have, which is the output of the flash, right? So I can bounce those two back and forth to get as much light as I need. Does that make sense? All right. Trick question. What should my metering mode be? Spot, matrix, whatever they call it. Who said it doesn't matter? You're right. It doesn't matter. What are you metering? There's nothing to meter. You're shooting in manual. Who cares what the camera thinks the light is? Because I guarantee you, every time I shoot her, it's going to say it's underexposed like crazy because it doesn't know the flash is going to fire. So forget the meter. You can do it manually. Make sense?
Yep.
Okay. We talked about minimum shutter speed being 1/60th of a second. What is my maximum shutter speed?
Depends on your camera.
Depends on your camera.
200, 250, or something like that.
On this camera, it's 1/200th of a second. That is the maximum flash sync speed this camera will shoot at. Most cameras are right around in there, right?
1/60th.
It depends on the camera.
Yeah.
Right, but my max is 1/200th. If I shoot at anything faster than 1/200th, you get a really weird looking photo. What it'll look like is you'll get this photo and like half the top half will be lit up, mm-hmm. nice exposed, and the bottom half will be black or dark.
Yeah.
Anybody seen that before?
Yes.
Right, you're exceeding your sync speed of your camera.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's all that is. So, and with the camera being here, the flash being here, they don't know about each other. There's no ETTL or any of that nonsense involved. Everything's in manual. Okie dokie?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So some ways we can set this up. Edna brought in her rig, which is a very simple way of doing this. What she has here is a tripod with a sync cable. Right? This goes on her flash shoe. Mm-hmm. She puts her flash here. Fire away. It doesn't get any cheaper than this. What, $60 or so? Something like that?
In a while, I don't remember.
Who cares? This is a sub-$100 solution, right? A sync cable, S-Y-N-C, a sync cable. The best thing to do is take your camera and your flash, go over to Southeastern Camera, and tell them you need a sync cable, they'll set you up. Because the ends that you have here and the end that goes on your flash will depend on your gear. Some cameras have a little port where you can plug it straight in, others you have to use the hot shoe.
Right.
Doesn't matter. It solves the problem either way. Okie dokie. All right, so I would be a little bit more portable, so I'm using some radio triggers up here, but that's not important. And I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about equipment because we're a photography club, not a camera club. It doesn't really matter. All right, so we'll do something simple here. So I've got Edna sitting over here, and we'll turn our flash on. We'll turn our radio trigger on. That should fire. All right, a little transmitter dude here, which goes on top of the camera. And we're set up here for a tether. I realize that umbrella is going to be in the way, but we'll move it to show the shots. So the idea here is I want to be able to let you guys see what we're shooting as we shoot it. So we'll set up for a sync here. All right, so we should just plug in there. Okay, so my flash is firing. So, how much power to put on the flash?
1/32?
No, not yet. You can start there, 1/32. That's about half power on the flash. Good place to start. Really, the best way to know is to use a light meter. Who has a light meter? Anybody? I don't. I never have gotten around to buying one. There's nothing wrong with them. I just never have gotten around to buying one. And there are other ways that you can do it just about as easy. So what I usually do is guess at it, like Edna said. So we'll start out, I don't know, somewhere around maybe half power. And with this little trigger here, I can actually control the power of the flash from the transmitter. If not, if I was using a sync cable like Edna has, I'll just go up here and adjust the dial on the back of the camera. It's the same thing. Right? So the idea here is we're just going to start out with a basic shot, and what did we get? So tell you what, turn that way. There you go, just a little bit. That's good. And we're going to go for, you know, maybe a half shot here. So we can get that fire.
Yeah.
All right. So I just want to load here eventually. Can somebody knock this beer out of the way? Just close it. There you go. All right. So you can kind of see it. The shot is really dark, right? And it's because I did not shoot enough flashing. Everybody see that? All right. So all we gotta do here is just add a little more power. So that's all I'm gonna do is just keep adding power and adjusting the flash until it gets to the point that it's somewhere that looks pretty good. All right? What do you think? It's pretty straightforward, isn't it? Really not bad.
The adjustment you made was to move the reflector closer?
I got the angle right. I looked better at what the light this was coming in and looked at the way the reflector was hitting. The other way to do it is to stand here and put that pan back where it was. You got a little button here on this, you see, you just look at it. Right? So I'm looking at it here, and I can see the left side of her face, mm-hmm. and I can see the right side of her face. You see where the light's starting to be kind of evening up on her. Yeah? Pretty easy, huh? So really do that in just a couple of steps. Adjust the power, adjust the angle, we're good to go. Questions on that so far? So we're going to add another little kink into it here in a second.
For this ambient light, what was the flash setting that you started at?
I don't know. I'm at about 2/3 power.
Okay.
Something like that.
Is that a thumb rule that you would suggest?
No. Because we're not getting a lot from the ambient. It's pretty dark up here. I mean, we're really not getting that much. If we were to open these shades up here and get some light bouncing off this wall here, then we'd have ambient into the mix and I would pull my flash down. So right now my primary light source is pretty much all flash.
Thank you.
Okie dokie. All right, another trick question I forgot to ask a minute ago. White balance. What should my white balance be?
Flash.
Flash? Good place to start?
Daylight.
Daylight and flash are?
The same.
Very good. Somebody in their basic photography class. Daylight and flash are the same color temp. So pick one. I'm shooting in RAW, so technically it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Now, when I say that, I'm not going to get into another JPEG versus RAW discussion because, my God, that subject's been beaten to death. Where it does matter, though, is when I...
never die.
And I know, and I just want to just slap people when you start. Where it does matter, though, is when you get into Lightroom at home and you're doing your post-production, you want to get that light right. You want to get that white balance right. Okay? Everybody heard of the gray card? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Got this fancy gray card. I don't know if I have mine here or not. Actually, I forgot to get it out. Anyway, I think I have one in here somewhere, if I can find it. And there's all kinds of solutions for gray cards out there. There's expensive ones. Let's see if I've got it. And I don't see it right now. Anyway, the gray card that I usually use, I wish I had it with me. It's one of the gray paint sample chips from Home Depot. Free. And you know what? It doesn't matter. It's close enough, right? And it's free. Go get 20 of them if you want. It doesn't really matter what shade of gray it is. It's just somewhere in kind of some kind of middle gray. It could be flat, glossy, who cares?
It doesn't matter that it's a neutral gray.
And just pick something in the middle.
Yeah.
Pick something in the middle.
You don't want any kind of tint.
That's right. So what I'll have her do is I'd have her hold the gray card, and I'd take a shot in this light with her holding that gray card. When I get into Lightroom, do the little eyedropper thing, and select the gray card. And bink, my white balance is set for that shot, and every other shot I take, as long as the light doesn't change. As long as the light doesn't change. If you add a little light, if you gel the light, if the sun comes up, the sun goes down, somebody opens the shades here, you've got to redo your white balance. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. And the same is true if you use aperture rather than Lightroom too.
Okay, they're all the same. Yeah. I certainly don't want to get into that discussion.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, there's tons of, I keep saying Lightroom because I've been using it for years and it's just what I've used. So they're all good. All right, everybody good so far? Any questions? Anybody?
For a quick built-in gray card, mm-hmm. you can find somebody with gray hair, like I've got a patch.
Yep. Sure can.
Put me in the picture. And
a lot of times, if I forget to shoot the gray card, find a spot somewhere on one of your shots that has a neutral area, right? You can find like a place where there's a shadow in the fold of her shirt, something like that. You can do a white balance off of that. Okay, there's lots of things you can use.
So how do you
give me that gray card again in Lightroom? So I have the gray card, for instance.
Yeah, well,
and then in Lightroom,
let's do that afterwards. That's not really part of this. So what I'll show you later. What we'll do is we'll take a picture of you with the gray card when I can find it.
Okay.
You'll hold the shot. Hold the gray card. And then in Lightroom, I will white balance that shot and then apply that white balance to every shot we took in that group. So they'll all be right. That's the easiest way to do it.
Sure. Just a quick question. Yeah. My camera supports doing TTL controls
yeah.
to the camera.
Yeah.
Is there any reason we couldn't do that?
You can, but I've tried shooting off-camera TTL before, and man, is it a pain. You chase it all the time. Does anybody know what TTL is? TTL metering? Right, the idea behind TTL is now we're going to let the camera meter the exposure and adjust the flashes. And to me, it's too many variables. Because I'm going to put another flash up here in a minute, so I've got the camera, and I've got two flashes, and TTL will fight it. Plus, it's damn expensive. To do off-camera, TTL is expensive. It like triples the cost of your triggers. Like $300 or $400 a piece. It gets expensive.
Maybe we can retake that and make the flash a little stronger. I just
sure.
want to see what that would do.
Sure. Minus, in fact, that is a little bit underexposed.
Yeah.
So let's bring this up a little bit. And I'm going to make one more change here. Let's do... Okay. All right. Pretty good there. All right. Pretty small. All right.
Good.
Okay. And on three. One, two, three. Good. All right. Let's see if we get a little bit better shot this time. There we go. So we're still a little bit dark on this side, so I think my reflector is probably out of place, or my flash may have been out of place on that one. We've got a couple more this way. Okay. So how would you practice this at home if you want to do it? Shoot anything, right? Shoot your wife, shoot one of the kids. If you have nothing else, set a stuffed animal up. And take 500 pictures of a stuffed animal until you get the exposure the way you want. It works. I know you're laughing, but it works.
They don't
Plus,
move.
They don't move. They don't go to the bathroom, and they don't argue with you all the time. All right? Yeah, I've done it. Man, I sat there and shot a panda bear from the state fair one time for like 3 hours, you know, just trying to figure out what made it look good. You'd be surprised how much you will learn doing that.
Bruce Peterson does that for his wildlife photographers, but he uses a stuffed owl.
Yeah, an owl, whatever. Anything you got. All right, let's try another one and see if we can get this light to even up a little bit. One, two, three. Good. All right. Practice, practice, practice. Play with it at home. It's cheap. It's easy. All right, that one loaded at the lab. That one's loading up. Okay, so we're starting to get it pretty close here. All right, we're getting some light on the cheek. We've got a catch light in the eyes. Everybody knows what a catch light is, right? A little white dot in the eyes. It adds life to your photo. It makes it look like you're taking a picture of a live person instead of a mannequin or something.
So how much more did you increase your flash?
Just a touch, maybe I just give it a little tweak. You know, this is digital, who cares? Take 5,000 photos till you find the one you like. All right, that's the beauty of it. Any other questions before we add another?
Okay, so I kind of understood the aperture. You chose the aperture.
Huh?
And I understood the speed based on the lens that you have.
Yeah.
And ISO, you said 200, 400, doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And then, so you started two-thirds for flash.
Yeah.
And then started putting your way up.
Just tweak it.
Okay.
Yeah. Just get it close, and then do tiny little changes up and down until you get it dialed in.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Real quick, you're using reflect.
Uh-huh.
Do you ever shoot through umbrellas?
I do, and we'll do that in a minute. We'll change this up when we're done with the reflector here. Is there any other questions on the reflector shot before we move on?
I'm really new with this. I just got my first
okay.
shoot light.
Good.
Do you need a transmitter? Or
no.
I use a Canon 7D.
Nope. Go cheap. Get this.
Okay, so...
This is like $15, man.
Mm-hmm.
Much cheaper.
So I'm newer than her. What is the speed light?
Flash.
Another
flash. So
the flash.
Okay.
So the flash goes on that cable.
Yeah, the flash goes on the end of this tripod right here.
Okay.
And this goes into the hot shoe of my camera.
Okay, and it doesn't get in the way of your pictures at all.
No. Yeah, because this is in front.
Okay.
And this will stretch out a good 15 feet or so.
Okay.
All right? That gets that flash away from the camera. We don't like the flash right over top because of the nasty red eye reflections, all the problems that come along with that.
One warning though, if you have old flashes around, you probably want to be careful because some of the old flashes, the voltage that they use for syncing is too high and it can actually damage your camera.
Yeah, that's another discussion for another day. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that.
What is this called?
Sync cable. S-Y-N-C. A sync cable. It's been around for 50 years. Okay? Southeastern camera can set you up. Yep.
So now my question is more on quality. So you've gotten your light mapped out right.
Yep.
Would you just start adjusting your aperture so that the background's not that great?
Well, the only time I would adjust apertures up if I didn't like my depth of field.
Well, what I was saying is the background there, those pictures where you can see your flash and stuff.
Yeah, I'm not wild about the background either, but yeah, I got to do what I can do in here. I might do a little bit shallower depth of field. We come down to, and we go to 60 at 4.5. So now I've opened my aperture up. So to compensate, I'm going to pull my flash down, right? I can do that and try to shoot a little bit shallower depth of field so we don't have the ridiculous paintings in the background. Sure.
I'm sorry.
It's all right.
Okay, I understand the relationship between the ISO, shutter speed, and apertures.
Yep.
So my flash has the settings, half, one-fourth.
That's what we're doing. We're doing half, one-fourth, one-eighth, but I'm controlling it from here.
Okay.
Okay? If I didn't have a trigger, if I was using a cable, I would walk over to the flash and dial it up or down.
So is it the same relationship?
Same thing. Nothing changes. The other thing this does is it gets rid of the cable.
Now if I go one stop higher, let's say in 5.624, one stop, right?
So one stop, open aperture, I gotta pull one stop off the flash.
So that would be one setting down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Make sense? All right, let's change it up a little bit. Let's get rid of the reflector. And we can start getting a little bit more creative by bringing in a second flash. So that's what we have here. Is another speed light sitting on an umbrella. And this is typically what we would call the fill, right? The fill. So I'm getting a key light.
Charles.
Oh, sorry.
Your cable's under there.
No, sorry. Thank you. So our key light, our primary light, what happened to our projector there? Alright, so the idea here is we're going to have our key light at high 45. Right, to get that left side of her face nice and pretty. And I'll bring in my fill light, and normally what I'll start out with is move it over to right along here, down lower, and shoot it in this way. The idea is to just fill in that one side of her face. So it's not sitting in shadow. Everybody good with that idea? All right, let's see if we can get that set up. All right, let me know when that's about. Is that up right there, 45 and 45? By the way? Okay. All right, so put that there for our film. I'm going to try to get it out of the way of the projector, so it's going to be a little bit further away than I normally shoot it. Put this one right along in here. And now I've got to turn this on. Okay. Now, we got two flashes to deal with, right? We've got that one over there, this one over here, and they're both going to be firing at the same time, right? You got to figure out how much light do you want out of each flash. Now, I know the way we're shooting this, I want more out of this one and less out of this one. And you can get all into the ratios and all that kind of good stuff. They talk about the 4/5 ratio and all that kind of stuff. I tend to do it a little bit simpler than that. What I'm going to do here is turn number 2 here all the way down so it does not fire. It should be just number 1, right? Yep. This is the only flash that's going to fire here, is the first flash. We'll shoot that till we get the light the way we like on one side of her face. Okay? We're going to turn that flash off. Turn this one on. We'll adjust this flash until the fill is like we want it. Turn the other one back on. Should be good to go. Make sense? Small adjustments. Pick one thing at a time and get it right. Then add the next one in. Okay? So let's do that. We should be pretty close on it from before. So, okay. Let's go right in here. Okay, and we're still at 60 and 6.3, so yeah, probably more depth of field than we want, but that's okay. All right, so this shot, we're probably going to have, again, a lot of light on one side, and virtually none on the other, which is exactly what we've got. The light on that one side, not bad. Might be a little bit dark. I'll bring it up a touch. All right, so we'll add another, maybe another half a stop or two-thirds of a stop in. Okay, and right there. Let this one load. We'll see what we've got. It never happened fast enough, can it? Come on.
No, it's
a... Oh, there it goes. All right. So that's pretty good. That might be a little bit much for her. So I'm going to back that down a touch. But we're getting close. So I don't want to change the adjustment, so all I want to do, turn that flash off so it'll hold a setting. These flashes are already on. We'll start bringing the light up on it, and I'm just going to look at it here. Should be starting to come up. Okay, so that's starting to add some light in on her. Okay, it's a little bit too much straight on, so I'm getting a little bit too much light on the other side of her face. So what I'm going to do is swing that light away. If you get technical, that's a term called feathering. You feather your light away from your model. Okay, still a little bit too much. Okay, that's actually looking pretty good. All right. Now, if we take that shot right there, she should have just light. Really, on one side, it's probably going to be pretty dark, but that's okay. This is just a demo. Idea, get an idea where we are. This is really dark.
It doesn't flash.
Did it flash?
Mm-hmm.
And that shows how much the ambient light is to the exposure.
I know. There's not much. Not at 160 to 6.3. Fire that, Tom?
It's plenty, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, very little light out of that. So I'm going to bring this up another half stop or so. You can see here it's almost completely dark.
Okay.
Getting there. I'm looking at the back of the camera here, so I'm cheating a little bit. Okay. All right, that should be getting close. Okay. And 1, 2, 3. Good. All right. We're starting to get some light on that side of the shot at this point. Still pretty dark. Probably add a little more. We're getting close though. Now that I'm close, we'll bring in select light. And we'll try to go for some shots. Okay. And on three. 1, 2, 3. Good. And let's see what we get. Not too shabby. Do you guys see that at all? I'm going the way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's getting pretty good. Still a little bit dark. Maybe on that side?
Oh,
no, they're good. Yeah. Oh, there goes. They finally showed up.
Thoughts? It's a shadow on her face.
Yeah. But we want some shadow on her face. We want some relief here. We want this shadow here to appear because otherwise we're firing the flash straight on at her. We all know what that looks like.
Yeah. Looks like an IV feature.
Yeah. Looks like a mugshot down at the Wake County Jail. Everybody's seen those before. Okay, so let's get some, let's get another idea. Give me that chair right there that Devin was using. We'll push it, but I'm tied up by a cable. All right, let's do something else. There, what you doing? Yeah, so what am I doing here? Bringing a prop into the shot here. I want to give her a different way to pose, right? Women look good if you do a pose like this, they can do something like this, right? Women look good that way. When you're shooting pictures of women, have them slant their head a little bit to the side. Women look good with a little bit of slant in their eyes, like this. This is a feminine pose. This is a more masculine pose. Okay? So we're going to do some of that in this shot. All right. So what I want you to do is...
here.
And put your head, put your chin right there. Make sure it's just like that. And look, yep, that's it. That's what I'm looking for. All right. That's nice. All right. And on three, 1, 2, 3, good. I would probably shoot that closer to get the chair out of the way. Okay, let's do another one. Right there. 1, 2, 3, good. Okay. That's not too shabby. The next one I think is actually a little better. All right. That's it. That's all there is to it.
Yeah, how many years did it take?
Yeah.
easy. It's easy. You can do it. So you're up next. Come on. Get up here.
I don't have a...
All right, so set your camera.
I don't have a flash that's...
Wait, are you sunning off?
No.
No matter. Get rid of that.
Get rid of it, okay. I can't take it off. There's no...
Set your camera.
Uh-huh.
I said 400.
Okay, that I think I know I can do.
No. Yeah.
Yep, it is.
Okay, and do 1/60th. Put your camera in manual.
Okay.
All manual.
Help.
I don't know where he's in this camera.
Woo!
It's on the dial.
Dial up here. Somebody else get another camera ready. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. Get yours ready. What do you use? Give me a second. 1/400. Oh, sorry, 400. 60 at 6.3. 1/60th at f6.3. All right, right there. Come back to me. I think you're not in the angle. Yep. 6.3. Alright, you're ready to shoot. Alright, so we're going to get another shooter up here and let her start working with her model. So, what's the most important thing when working with a model?
Talk to your model.
You must direct your model. Tell them what you want to see. You can't expect the model to know where to pose, right? If you have a really, really, really expensive model, very experienced model, they will change on every shot, and they know how to do it. If you do it with an amateur model, you have to tell them what you want them to do. Okay?
I'm the amateur.
Was it flashy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What'd you get?
Oh, first of all, I think it's an issue.
It's actually pretty good. That's good. Who's ready? You ready? Come on. All right, I need to take the trigger back. I need the trigger.
All right.
Slides on.
So wait, it's mine.
Okay. That slides right on there.
If you don't mind doing that.
All right, there you go. Talk to your mom.
Okay, so I'm not paying attention to my metering. Right?
No, forget the metering. So you're ISO 400, 1/60th to 6.3. You should be good to go.
Yeah, just like
that. There you go. Talk to your model. Are you ready?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, you're next. Flash.
Perfect.
Yeah. Does anyone have a tripod?
No, it's
not bad, huh?
Can I just bring you? Yeah, really.
If you have.
There we go. All right. Fire away. Okay. While our shooter is shooting, who thinks they can do this at home? You do it at home?
I'm sure.
Sure you can.
But I have very big.
So we're shooting speed lights here, right? These are just battery power speed lights. Makes it really good when you want to do outdoor photography. You don't have cables and drop cords, that kind of stuff.
I have a question about using a hood on your lens.
For this, it wouldn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
Generally inside, probably.
Yeah.
No, it works really well.
What about if you're sort of on the fly? What do you think about those side bracket things?
Yeah. Like a flash bracket?
Yeah.
Close the flash?
Yeah, just got sort of get the flash on the center.
Yeah, I have one, and I do use it under some circumstances, right? If I'm shooting an event where I have to be moving all the time, like a wedding or something, I can't do all this. So I've got to use a bracket, and I like the bracket because no matter which way I turn the camera, the flash is up here, right? That's the point of the bracket. Now, that flash is only ever pointed straight at my subject. I'm bouncing it off the back walls, the side walls, anywhere I can to keep the shooting straight on.
And then the other thing that I've seen, though I'm not exactly sure how it works, for flash ring?
A ring flash?
Yeah.
That's for really close-up shots.
Okay.
That's like, you know, the nose close-up shot.
Really?
Yeah, it's a very nice, even light, but it's for really close. All right, this goes on. Shoot that. All right. Yeah.
You had a circular polarizer that looked like a minute ago here, showing somebody.
We were just talking about it. We would not shoot that in here.
Yeah.
Would it take some of the glare off her cheek there?
It might. I would really rather do that by makeup. Really would be my best choice.
Okay.
You know, the makeup artist would fix that. Other solutions, I could pull the light down a little bit. But I don't know. I've never used a polarizer in a studio before.
I was just wondering.
It might.
You said it.
You know, it costs you a stop of light, so you can compensate for that. But I've never used one in a studio. Yeah.
Is there anything to consider by putting out the umbrellas? On the umbrellas that you pick, is there anything that you get?
Oh, yeah. Size of the umbrella. Everybody's seen umbrellas before. You get them this big, you can get them this big, and you can get them as tall as you can stand. Everybody seen those before?
Yeah.
The idea behind the size of the umbrella is this dictates how much of your subject you can light up, right? This umbrella is too small for me to do a full standing shot of a model and get even lighting top to bottom. If I want to get her shoes and her hair and she wants to do something like this, you know, she's six and a half feet tall with her arms stretched out, I cannot do it with umbrellas this size. You've got to go bigger. This is good for headshots and waist up. Right? You can cheat it a little bit and pull them back, but it's not going to be an even light. Right, direct your model.
All right. Can you use a wall? Can you just flash against the wall to get a broader...
Sure can. If I'm doing on-camera flash because I can't do all this,
right.
I guarantee you I'm going to be bouncing it off these walls.
Right, but I'm just thinking if you had somebody that you wanted to get standing.
Yeah.
Could you use the wall? Could you use the ceiling as a wall?
Yeah, absolutely.
And that would give you light up across.
That will give you a larger apparent light size.
Right.
Which is the whole point.
What are you shooting?
400.
400?
Yep.
Yeah. Overexposed.
466 feet should do it.
Yeah.
It's going to vary by camera.
The top of one. I can move it too
much. Other questions? Who's our next shooter? Who wants to shoot the model? You shoot?
If you have a sync cable, you can connect to one flash or you can connect multiple flashes.
You can multiple, they have a Y.
Oh, and also you don't need a sync cable if you have a wireless flash.
Right, I'm doing wireless here because it's just more convenient.
Yes, master commander kind of thing.
Yeah, these are just radio poppers. It's a fairly inexpensive wireless flash solution.
Okay.
It's a lot less expensive than Pocket Wizard.
Okay.
I mean,
and what's it called?
Radio popper.
Radio popper.
Radio popper. It's just a remote trigger.
And it doesn't matter what camera.
Nope.
It'll
fit. Yep. The only exception is a Sony camera because it has a different flash shoe, so you have to put that adapter on there. Yes.
The Canon 7D has a wireless transmitter built into it.
Yeah, this one does too, and I don't use it. It's infrared.
It's line of sight.
And it's line of sight, and that just annoys me. So I went with radio instead.
What does that mean? What's line of sight? The camera has to see the flash.
Yeah.
There can't be a
flash. Probably won't be working away with that.
Anybody else want to shoot? Come on.
Sure.
Are you getting tired?
No. She's sitting down.
All right, so this goes on just like we did that. Fire away. Okay, you want to shoot the model? Okay. Yeah, I mean, actually, I kind of do. I want to talk about shooting the glass. Nope. I want to do a single shot, but that's all right. What else can we talk about while we're waiting for her to get her shot?
She's going to do one with glasses to have.
Yeah, we're going to shoot her next. She has glasses, so we'll talk about that. Yeah. Do you have something you like?
Yeah.
Cool. I'm not sure. I might do a valley light.
Okay, yeah.
Or you can set it in post.
Yeah, right.
Set it in post.
Right. So that's the radio.
That's the transmitter.
And it's good for how many?
Three groups. So you can do three flashes, or you can do groups of flashes that all have the same set. So I lead.
Okay.
Let's change models. Come on up. Thank you. All right, so we're going to change models here. it's Robin, right? Okay. Yeah, we'll use it. We'll just go public for a minute. So, I'm actually glad Robin's up here because she has glasses on. Everybody done pictures of people with glasses before? What's the tricky part about that? The reflection off the bloody glasses. You know, it gives away your shot. You know, you can see the, sometimes you see like television commercials, right? You can actually see the umbrella. If you look close enough, you can actually see the sun in the glasses if you're not careful. So what we're going to do here is we're going to look real close at our angles. The idea behind getting the reflection off of the glasses is to bring that light in from an angle. So it doesn't go straight at the person, it comes straight back. Okay? So if we angle it off, it may do pretty well. So we're going to try what we have right here, see how it goes. Alright? Alright, so let's do... Yeah, turn the body so you're facing that way just a little bit. And let's do the tilt and take all of your hair and put it on that side. Okay, that's what I like. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm having her tilt her head this way, right? And then I had her put all of her hair on this side of her face. It frames her face nicely. You see how it looks here? All the hair is on this side. So it gives you a nice contrast in the shot. Right? So a lot of tricks that you can use to try to make your, whoops, try to make your model look a little better in the shot. This will be good. All right, and
right here, two here, and on three, one, two, and three, good.
All right, that's a little bit bright, so I'm going to back this thing down a bit. It's a little bit cold. All right, let's do one more.
And on tight, one, two, three, good.
All right, we're getting close. This will load up. What do you think?
Good.
Not too bad. We didn't even get any reflections right off the bat. That's because we've angled our light. We've feathered the reflector away from her, and we're bringing the light in an angle where it doesn't bounce off. Questions?
So the reason you're using this one, the fill straight on, is to give more shadows, as opposed to the other 45 on the other side, right?
Exactly. If I had like a group of like eight people up here, and I've got to get a shot of all of them, I got to do 45-45. I can't get creative in my lighting with that many people that being that wide. With one person, I want a little bit of shadow here, right? Some relief in her face. That doesn't look like she's, you know, the Wake County mugshot. You know, I want something a little more interesting and creative in that, so I'm bringing the light in at an angle. And this one here is just to fill in on that side. You can do it with a reflector. You can do it with another flash. Second flash gives you a little bit more versatility. That's about it.
Another trick with glasses is you can ask the subject to raise the
back of the glasses.
Whatever you call these things, the arms, so that they're up.
If you have
the lenses.
Yeah,
down.
If there's nothing else you can do, have your model or whatever it is, raise the back of the glasses, and it tilts the glasses down a little bit. So now the light hits the glasses and goes downward underneath the camera lens instead of straight back into the camera lens. Good trick. Okay, if you're shooting on-camera flash and you're blasting it right at them, you know any other way to do it? Try that. That will keep the reflection out of it.
Another thing you really didn't mention was the effect of the distance between the flash and the subject.
Yeah, I mean, what I'm really doing here is trying to stay out of the projector more than anything else.
Yeah.
But, you know, the further away you get, the wider your apparent light source is, so I'm lighting up more of my subject, so I can get her from, you know, maybe the top of her head down to her waist. But I got to apply more power for this same amount of light, right? So that would inverse square law. Inverse square.
And it's inverse square, so it's quite a bit of...
It is quite a bit.
You move it back and lose quite a bit.
If I double the distance, I got to quadruple the power. It gets dark in a hurry. So yeah, but that the idea there is, you know, how close does my light rig need to be to my subject? And it just really depends on how much power your flash has, how much light you're getting from ambient light, and how much of your subject you want to light up. Who else wants to shoot? Anybody? I know somebody else brought a camera. Angela, get up here and shoot. ISO 400, 60 at 6.3.
Are you going to show what the difference is? Because I have a clear, not clear, but a white umbrella that doesn't have the black, so I have to shoot through it.
Okay.
And are you going to tell what the difference is between...
We can talk about shoot through versus bounce, because what we're doing here is a bounce. This one will also do a shoot through, right? I can take this off, right? And it'll do a shoot through. The idea there is you take the thing off, you spin it around, and then you actually shoot through it.
And is that softer?
Okay. So it is softer, and here's why. When I'm shooting this way, I'm shooting through, my flash comes here, it hits this, it comes through. It also hits the room back around here, and it brings light in from there. Okay? If I'm doing a pure bounce, the black stops this. Black stops this from coming through, so it comes straight in. You got the polarizer on there?
So which do you use?
It depends. If I'm doing, I did a shot the other day, I was doing there was a piece of networking gear, it was like a big switch or something like that, and I needed really close shots of like the knobs and switches and the port plugs on it, that kind of stuff. I would do a shoot through on that, and man, the umbrella was like this far off the front of that switch. Because I want a big, giant light source that wrapped all around, and it lit inside, it lit the little corners, and it lit up the screws. So I do a shoot through on that.
Okay.
Play with it. You know, get you this umbrella kit's like $60. Get you an umbrella kit and play with it both ways. Shoot through, shoot bounce. You ready? All right, fire away. Direct your model. I'll say that a million times. Talk to your model.
What kind of radio pilot are you using?
It's the radio pilot.
Oh, it is a radio pilot.
It's the cheap one. You ready? Yeah, 400, 6863. What else can we talk about while we're waiting? Oh, what about this? It's really about all there is to it. Oh, the rate card. I can find it. Not sure where it is. That'll work. That would certainly work. All right, should we take a picture of him? That way. All right, here we go. All right, so the one change I would make to her pose here is, if she has her hand here, make sure she curls her fingers. All right? If it bends, bend it. Women do not look good like this, right? Bend the elbows, curl the fingers. Okay. Thank you. All right, you ready to shoot? Oh, that's what I've got to talk about. Shooting pictures of people. Minimum focal length lens for shooting a picture of a person. What is it? Yeah. Got smart ass over here in the corner. All right. What did we say?
I was saying 50.
50 is about as small as I'll go, right? Do not shoot pictures of people with a 15 millimeter lens, unless you like them to look like clowns, because they will. And try to know. Get your widest angle lens, go to your widest setting, and get right up on somebody and take a shot. Their nose will get huge and their ears will look like Dumbo. But that lens will distort at that distance, right? I see people do it all the time. Like, no, stop. You cannot shoot a model with a 15 millimeter lens. Back up. Somewhere around 50 millimeters is where it starts to look pretty good. See, a lot of pros shooting at 85? 85 millimeters?
105 is sort of a traditional one.
105? Well, you got to have a heck of a big studio to do that.
Yeah.
To get a standing model at 105 millimeters, you're back here. Yeah. Right, anybody else shooting? Did you get something you like? Yeah. That's cute. Yeah, that I was really nuts. You got her laughing.
Yeah.
All right. One thing we'll do, turn your camera this way.
Okay.
Right?
Thank you.
Shooting pictures of, shooting a shot of one person. Right? This is your one person orientation. This is your two person orientation. You need three people, kind of got to do this. Right? When you're shooting people, one person, portrait orientation, and fill the viewfinder with your subject. Right? What I should do is focus on the eyes, hear it beep, and I'll move down a little bit. Focus on the eyes, move down a little bit. It's called focus and recompose. The idea is I don't need that big giant white box up there as part of my photo. I'd edit it out anyway. Okay? And then on the fly, I'm taking your shot from here. Make sense? Are you shooting?
Some of these cameras, when you haven't used the hot shoe, that it's pretty tight.
Yeah, that was. Yeah. Some of them. Okay. Okay, so everybody see what Edna's doing there, and you saw me do it, where I'm sitting down here and I'm shooting at this level, right? I'm not standing up here and shooting down unless I really want to, right? It's especially true when you're shooting children, and all of you have kids. When you're taking pictures of kids, shoot kids at their level. Get down on the floor with them, because that's their point of view of the world. This is what they see. You know, the worst thing you do is get right over a kid and shoot that. It's a horrible photo. Okie dokie. I can find that gray card you guys
have. I have a question. You said that you were trying to get the light of that, the reflection in their eye. When they have glasses, are you trying to get it in their glasses?
It doesn't really matter. Actually, in your shot, we've got it in your eye. Yeah. There's a little bit of reflection here and here.
Yeah.
Right? And I probably wouldn't really worry about that too much, because it's not an important part of the shot. If it really bothered me, I'd probably pull it out in Photoshop or Lightroom or whatever.
Okay.
But we have a nice catch light in your eyes right here. It's kind of hard to see it with this projector, but
okay.
It's actually pretty good. Let me find this gray card that you're talking about. All right, shooting with a gray card. Let me get the, who's got the transmitter?
Yeah.
All right. So, my gray card has to be this gray notebook. It's as good as any, right? Have my model, hold it. You want to have her kind of put it maybe just right under her chin, kind of right where she's going to, where the light is most important, which is right there on her face, which is what I care about. I just have her hold that. It doesn't really matter about her pose because this is just a silly gray car shot. Okay? So now we have this. It will appear in Lightroom here in a minute. And it has a reflection on it. Doesn't make a bit of difference. Come in here into Lightroom. We'll go into... Come on. And what we're looking for here is this little eyedropper right here. Grab that, you pick the gray spot, there you go, white balance is set. Mm-hmm. So that warmed it up. Okay. So now I have that white balance, and there's a cute little trick in Photoshop where you can say, take this setting and apply it to all the pictures, and it will only take that one setting that you selected, just the white balance. So if you do crops and rotates and color corrections on all of them, you say just apply that one setting to all of those. It's pretty easy, huh? Yeah, let's just, Edna and, Andrew, come on up here. So we'll do three models.
Yes.
Actually, let's do two to start with, and we'll do standing shots with us. So whose white card was this? Okay. So we're going to do two model standing shots, so I have to adjust my lights, right? Because they're sitting too low. This has got to come up. All right, somewhere around there. I should kind of stand over here and look and see where they're going. That's going to pull it just a touch. Okay. And come somewhere right in here. All right, the fill, who knows? I'll have to see how it goes. All right. Posing a pair of women. All right. The last thing you want to do is what they were doing a minute ago, which is both of them standing here like statues. Not very pretty. Things that you can do. People look good together in a shot when they are connected in some fashion. When I say that, what do I mean by connected in some fashion?
Touching.
They could be holding something, right? They're both holding a paintbrush or something. I don't know. Something that's contextual to the shot that you're after. You can have them touching each other. You can kind of do... women kind of can do the arm-in-arm thing.